It was 1893, and Madras was a state presidency under the British rule. On 23rd March, in a village of Kalangal, 16 miles away from Coimbatore, Doraisamy was born to Gopalsamy and Allamal. Doraisamy lost his mother when he was merely a toddler. He started his preliminary education under the supervision of his uncle in the village of Lakshmi Nayakan Palayam. Doraisamy was a mischievous boy who hated going to school. In class 3, he was frequently punished for hurling sand and throwing stones at his teachers during class. In order to control his son's rebellious behavior, Gopalsamy decided to send him to live in a house in the middle of a field on the outskirts of Kalangal. All day, Doraisamy would work in the fields, and at evening, he would teach himself to read books in Tamil. One day, as Doraisamy was walking in the fields, he came across a bottle with a label written in English. Unable to read it, the next day he approached a Britisher and asked him about the bottle. The Britisher explained that the bottle was Park Davis, a painkiller. With the help of the Britisher, he imported the painkiller from America and sold it to the villagers at a marginal profit. This helped him earn a profit of Rs. 800 that year. In the same year, Doraisamy met with the landowner and took up the cause of increasing the wages of the peasants who worked on his land all day long. During the period of negotiation, the laborers were without any income. Doraisamy distributed the Rs. 800 he had earned to the peasants. One day, a Britisher revenue officer called Lancashire visited Kalangal on a motorcycle. That day proved to be a turning point for Doraisamy. The motorcycle had some trouble, and the British officer asked Doraisamy to fetch him some kerosene and a rag. As he handed over the kerosene and rag to the Britisher, Doraisamy watched carefully as he set about repairing the motorcycle. Doraisamy was always fascinated with mechanical objects, and it came as no surprise that he was captivated by the motorcycle. He started thinking about the mechanism behind the vehicle and how it could move without any external power, such as horses or bullocks. The next day, Doraisamy walked all the way to Coimbatore. He spent his first day exploring Coimbatore and absorbing all the new experiences a big town had to offer. With no money in hand, he took up a job as a waiter at a hotel at a salary of Rs. 3 a month. In 3 years, he had saved Rs. 400 by doing odd jobs and chores. In an effort to pursue his dreams, he sought out the British officer Lancashire again. Impressed by his fascination of machines, Lancashire sold his motorcycle to Doraisamy, who took it apart completely so that he could understand how the mechanism worked before reassembling it.
Thank you.
The next few years saw G.D. Naidu take up a job at a ginning factory in Ondipudur. Subsequently, he set up his own facility in Senganallur. This was during the First World War, and G.D. Naidu adopted certain extremely innovative techniques in his factory, which helped him earn as much as 100,000 rupees in a year's time. Then he decided to go to Bombay and get into cotton trading, a business which is considered to be as risky as gambling. He returned to Coimbatore once again, without a penny in hand.
Around the year 1918, my father was into various businesses, but mainly in the cotton business, he lost a lot of money. Finally, he came back from Bombay to Coimbatore and he worked in a restaurant as a server. At that time, Mr. Staines had the only workshop in Coimbatore. And he was the agent for Chevrolet trucks, and he was importing them and selling them. My father did not know English, so he somehow went and managed and joined Staines in the house to clean the kitchen and to work with Mrs. Staines. The idea was, when he is with that English lady, he'll be able to learn English. He worked in the daytime in a restaurant as a server, and in the evenings he used to go to the house and learn English. The money which he earned, he gave it to her to keep for safekeeping. At a particular stage, Mr. Staines had a liking to my father and asked him, "What are you going to do with the money?" My father said, "I want to buy a bus." Mr. Staines said, "It's going to take a long time for you to save the money and buy a bus. I'll give you a bus which you run and you try to pay back the amount."
அந்த ஒரு பஸ் நானே 365 நாளும் ஓட்டி ஒரு நாளும் கூட நிக்காத ஓடி முதல்ல உடுவனப்பேட்டையிலிருந்து திண்டுக்கல் வரைக்கும், அப்புறம் உடுவனப்பேட்டையிலிருந்து பொள்ளாச்சி பொள்ளாச்சி பழனின்னு கடைசியில் வச்சேன். இந்த பஸ் சர்வீஸ் ஆரம்பிச்ச பின்னிட்டு 12 வருஷம் ஒரு நாளும் கூட லீவ் இல்லாதபடிக்கு இருந்து ஒரு பஸ்ல ஆரம்பிச்ச பஸ் சர்வீஸ் 280 பஸ் ஆச்சு.
ஒரு பஸ்ல இருந்து எப்படி 260 ஆச்சுன்னா,
ஒரு பஸ் ஒரு வருஷத்துக்கு அப்புறம் அதுல கொஞ்சம் மிச்சமாச்சு, 100 ரூபாய்க்கு இன்னொரு பஸ் கிளீனரா சேர்ந்தவன் டிரைவர் ஆனா அந்த பஸ்ஸுக்கு டிரைவர். இந்த 2870 பேர் ஆனாத அவ்வளவு பேரும் எங்கிட்ட பழகினவங்களே தான்.
At a particular stage, he decided that he should set up a workshop, which he did very successfully. When all other bus companies did not have a workshop, he was able to maintain all the buses properly, and he was able to run it more economically than all other competitors. At that time, he found that many passengers facilities was not available in most other companies. Actually, all the buses used to go via Palladam to Tirupur, Kangayam, Pollachi, etc. So he decided to build a big bus junction in Palladam, purchased the property and built very modern bus junction, modern toilets, modern waiting rooms where the first class passengers can sleep overnight if necessary, He had the best canteen. European food was also served. One of its kind of in India, and was the first in India where a bus junction was there. He met all the other bus transport companies and they all formed an association. My father organized it and he became the managing director of the association. First time in India, you can buy a ticket in Madras and go to Kanyakumari by four different transport companies. And with one ticket, you can travel from one end to the other end. At one stage, he had in this association more than 600 buses and he managed all of them. This was the most successful venture he had. My father was one of the first persons to employ a British Englishman in the company. He wanted better systems to be introduced, better logistics to be improved, and he wanted this British man to come and introduce all the systems in India. His name was Mr. Hoots, and he stayed in the company for many years. In the year 1934, on 6th of February, Mahatma Gandhi visited Coimbatore. He was in a salt walk from Palladam to Ichanari on the way to Pollachi. He stayed in Pothanur in our guest house. Father used to follow him and had many discussions with him also. When he was staying in the guest house, Avanashalingam Chettiar approached him to lay the foundation stone for Ramakrishna Mission. Gandhi immediately agreed, but asked him, if I lay a foundation stone today, how long will it take for the institute to run? Avanashalingam Chettiar said, it might take 1 or 2 years. So he asked him, why not use this place to start the institute? He turned to my father and asked him, you are keeping it as a guest house, why don't you give it to him to start the institute without delay? My father immediately agreed and the institute was started there. This house still exists and we hope to make it as a memorial of Gandhi's visit to Coimbatore. My father was a very innovative man and he took all challenges in stride. He went to Belgium, joined a bakery and worked in the bakery so that he knows what he is going to eat. It's not non-vegetarian, it's vegetarian. Well, his work was to cut big loaves of bread into slices. This he used a knife and he was cutting it. During the wartime, there was a very big shortage of steel and steel blades were not available. So he used the same blade for quite a few days and the blade got blunt and he had a lot of cuts in his face. When he was slicing the bread, he got an idea. Instead of the blade coming just up to down, if it can vibrate, it will be like cutting the slice of bread. The blade also will cut the hair. So in the evening when he went back, he went to a toy shop and got a toy battery car, removed the motor, fixed it to a Gillett razor by rubber band and had a fantastic shave. This was more or less his first invention and he patented it in Germany. This was one of the first razors in the world which worked with the battery. When he started manufacturing the blades and the razor, he sold them in America and Europe. He had very big offers from other companies to buy out the whole design, but he refused to sell it. He wanted to make them in India so that the Indian country benefits from these innovations. Unfortunately, at that time, the British government did not allow him to make it in India. This was later demonstrated in Leipzig Fair. It got the first prize and third prize, which Hitler presided and gave. Later, when he was in Dusseldorf, he was in the streets wearing a dhoti. The police found him to be very unique, very different, and were trying to ask him to go back. Hitler saw this happening, stopped the car and asked him who you are and where you are from and what do you want. So my father just said, I want a photograph, to photograph you. He took a photograph of Hitler, and the next day he got it autographed by Hitler. During the wartime, my father was in Stuttgart. The Americans and the French were bombing Stuttgart, and everybody were going out of Stuttgart to the rural areas. He was walking in the street, half starving, very, very hungry, and at a particular in this village of Neidlingen, he sat down on the road. The old lady came and asked him what he was doing. In his half-broken German language, he explained he was going out of Stuttgart. So the lady found my father to be very weak and asked him, when did you eat last? So my father said, it's very difficult, I am a vegetarian. So the lady said, potatoes and carrots in my garden here, I'll give you vegetable meal. So then invited him to the house. My father went into the house, cleaned all the vessels and the kitchen, and then cooked potatoes and vegetables and ate it. As my father was very weak, the lady asked him to stay in this house for a few days. The whole family became vegetarian as long as my father stayed there. He wanted to go out of Germany, out of the war zone. So he told them that he wants to go out. In those days, there's no trains or buses or any means of transport because of the war and the bombing. Family which helped him, the lady, is Mrs. Stoll. It's the Festo company owners. This is one of the longest friendship we have had. It's more than 100 years. It's the fifth generation are also becoming friends, and they are part of the family. During the war, there was a very big shortage of electric motors in India. At that time, my father decided, why not make it in India? And he, along with Balasundaram of Textool, started working and made the first electric motor in India. When they started production, the British government thought that their products, which are exported from England, their market share will drop. They didn't want motors to be made in India. So what they did was, they put a high customs duty on the stampings which was used in the motors. My father decided, why not make the stampings? So he made a stamping machine, imported steel sheets and made the stampings in India.
Today, Coimbatore is the Manchester of India. And towards that, a good number of activities happened. And the base for that basic thing is the motors coming out, what all the activities happening there, the varieties of motors being done in Coimbatore, that is being going outside India, also good number of things are being exported from here. I think that seed start came from again Mr. J.D. Naidu.
At one time he had more than 600 buses and he had to maintain all these buses, not only in Coimbatore, throughout South India. And there were no mechanics available, and it was extremely difficult to maintain the buses. He went to America to Ford Motor Company and two or three other polytechnics, joined as a student, and he was the oldest student to join. He learned all about automobiles, how they teach. He came back to India and started a training center.
My grandfather started the automobile course in the year 1941 with the main intention to develop skilled automobile mechanics in the shortest duration of time.
In this training center, he saw to it that 10th failed boys can also be taught. He made his own syllabus and he started teaching. And his classes continued till about midnight or even more. The students were very enthusiastic because of the way he took the classes.
I gave in 1945 ₹150,000 and equipment for opening the first polytechnic in India.
It's a very great pleasure for me to come here this evening and to have the honor of opening this polytechnic, which has been named after myself. Mr. Naidu is an engineer, he's an inventor, and I'm neither. I've driven a motor car for very many years, but whenever it breaks down, I wait until somebody comes along. Mr. Naidu would not do that. For one thing, his car would not break down, and secondly, if it did, he'd know what to do with it.
Let me first of all thank you, Your Excellency, for giving us the honor of your presence today. There had been many occasions when Your Excellency was kindly present, but this occasion is one which will be remembered by me and all who are interested in the development of post-war industry. As most of you who have assembled here know, my life history is itself a history of automobiles for the last 25 years. I have been educating myself with all the first-hand experience in this country and other most advanced countries in automobiles and other industries. I have an opportunity with the establishment of this polytechnic to show in practice what real education ought to be. One thing is sure, that while every advanced country fits up its young men with an education that will be useful in practical life, both to the individual and the country, we cannot expect any hope for our country unless it comes in line with progressive countries in its system of education. The candidates have another advantage. They complete within 3 years a course in automobile engineering, which in my opinion, based on personal experience, will take about 6 years and 4 months in foreign countries. See that I decide to present this institute, the UMS library, for which I have been collecting books for the last 20 years. My conditions in handing out this library to the institute are that it should continue in the same way as it is now. Total value of the books, journals and magazines in the library is about ₹67,000. I request Your Excellency to accept this humble offer on behalf of your government.
He started a polytechnic with short-term courses, so the student can come and join and go into a profession very soon.
And this could be only possible because of his theory of 70% practical education and 30% theoretical education. And today, the entire industry, including the Confederation of Indian Industry, other associations, are complaining that we have a lot of engineering graduates passing out of college, but 80 to 90% of these engineering college graduates are not employable. The reason why they are not employable is, over a period of time, we teach only theory and we do not give them hands-on exposure. So I believe if the Indian educational system, the engineering colleges, simply follow the principle which was started by my grandfather, we will have a lot of hands-on engineers who can immediately contribute after they come out of college for the industry and the benefit of the industry.
And he has helped a lot of people. Charity, was kind to people, kind to his employees. And he bought a coach and he himself drove it for the people. And you know, his UMS became very, very popular transport service at that time. There was nothing else those days except in bullock carts. But whatever he touched, whatever he did, it was successful. Because he did it with a lot of sincerity and perfection. Excellence is his quality in whatever he did.
He spent a lot of time with me to improve my knowledge. This helped me a lot. He was very strict. He used to show me about the radios or recorders. He taught me how to operate it. And he used to explain to me a lot of things about the valves and capacitors, etc.
போலீஸில் வச்சு போட்டு 1.5 வருஷம் அமெரிக்காவுக்கு போயிட்டு அது துருப்பிடிச்சிருக்குது. அதை எடுத்து சுத்தம் பண்ணி குண்டு போகுதா இல்லையான்னு வாழை மரத்தில் விட்டேன். 7 மரத்தில் விட்டேன். 7 மரத்துலையும் தொலையாச்சு. அந்த தொலையில் ஒன்றுல களிமண், ஒன்றுல மாட்டு மூத்திரம், ஒன்றுல மட்டன், ஒன்றுல பேட்டரி ஆசிட் எல்லாம் போட்டு களிமண் வச்சு அடைச்சு போட்டேன். ரெண்டு செத்து போச்சு, ஒண்ணு நெடு நெடு நெடுன்னு வளர்ந்து வந்தது. ஆமா, ஓ இது என்னவோ இருக்குதுன்னு சொல்லி பின்னொரு 50 மரம் வச்சு அதே வேலையா ஆரம்பிச்சேன். 7 வருஷம் செய்யறேன். 7 வருஷம் தினம் 1 மணி நேரம் சாதாரணமா ஒரு விளையாட்டு மாதிரி செய்துட்டு.
This made him get interested in agriculture. He also started making research on red grams, on corn, cotton, and other agriculture products. The corn tree normally gives 1 cob, but the plant he made gave up to 36 or even more cobs. The only problem was it grew to the height of 15 to 20 feet and it could not stand the wind, and it used to be very difficult to grow the plant.
சோறு சாதாரணமாக ஒரு 6 மாதம் 8 மாதம் இருக்கும். இது 8 வருஷம் இருக்கும். 8 வருஷத்துலேயும் ஒவ்வொரு வருஷத்துலேயும் நம்ம ஊர் தவிர ஒரு 600 ராத்திலிருந்து 700 ராத்தல் வரைக்கும் கொடுக்குது ஒரு ஏக்கருக்கு. இது 5000 ராத்தல் கொடுக்குது. ஒரு ராத்தல் 2 ரூபாய்னு விற்றது. அப்போ 5000 ராத்தலன்னா 10000 ரூபா ஒரு ஏக்கருக்கு வரும்படி வரும். ஒரு சாதாரணமாக 4 பேர் உள்ள குடும்பம் வீட்டுக்கு ஒரு 6 செடி இருந்தால் போதும். வருஷம் பூராவும் இந்த தோரை வாங்க வேண்டியதே இல்லை. வருஷம் பூரா பச்சைக்காயாக எடுத்து சாம்பார் வச்சு சாப்பிடலாம்.
இந்த பப்பாயாவில் தக்காளி பழம் மாதிரி, வெள்ளரி பழம் மாதிரி, நிலம்பழம் அந்த மாதிரி, மாம்பழம் மாதிரி ஒரே கொம்பு வந்திருக்குது. உருவங்கள் வேற, உருவங்கள் வேற, எல்லாம் இனிப்பு. அந்த பப்பாயா வாசம் இல்லை. சீராவன் அப்படி வராதுன்னாரு நினைக்கிறாரு. அப்புறம் வந்து அந்த செடிக்கு பக்கத்துல புடுங்கிட்டு இதை எழுதி இருக்கிறாரு. ஒன்லி திஸ் மார்னிங் ஐ விசிட்டட் எ ஃபார்ம் நியர் போன்ட்னோ வேரியஸ்
created a whole series of botanic models.
He is the same genial ghost, the same person whose heart is set upon helping his young countrymen, his heart is set upon using his skill and knowledge to invent new things. It may be clocks, or it may be radiators, or it may be films, or it may be something else. He always wants to do something. One quite deliberately, I said that Mr. G. D. Naidu is a man in a million, and that even that was an understatement. It's not many.
G. D. Naidu, not only my father-in-law, he is my grandfather also. His work, whatever he has done, and being a philanthropist, he was always a man of the people. And he made the first radio, which costed only 100 rupees. And that is, even now, many people are having it. And they, even now, after so many years, the radios are working. He always wanted to give people in a very low cost.
My father developed many things for the first time in India. For instance, he was one of the first to make ball pens, ball pen refills in India. Similarly, he made a very low cost clock in India. Carbon ribbons, and even the machines were made in India.
எத்தனை தொழில்கள் இப்போ வரையா இருக்கு உங்களுக்குல 63 தொழில்கள் டீசல் நாஜில் செய்யறது ப்ரொஜெக்டர் செய்யறது கடிகாரம் செய்யறது
அப்படிலாம்
மிஷினே செய்யறது
என்ன விதமான
முதல் லேத்துகள் ட்ரில்லிங் மிஷின்கள் டிக்கெட் கொடுக்குற மிஷின்கள் இதெல்லாம் ரொம்ப ஹைலி ஸ்கில்டு தொழில்கள் இதெல்லாம் ரொம்ப நுட்பமான தொழில்கள் அந்த தொழில்கள் எல்லாம் இந்த சாதாரண ஆளுகளுக்குண்டே தான் தேர்ட் ஃபார்ம் ஃபோர்த் ஃபார்ம் படித்த ஆளுகளுக்குண்டே தான் செய்துட்டு வர்றேன்.
My father was very concerned with many of the poor people living in thatched houses or living in the open. That he started experimenting with making a low-cost house at the fastest time. After about 2 years of research and development, he wanted to give the house for less than 1,000 rupees and to be built in one day. He succeeded in this. He invited the Vice President, Mr. Giri, to Coimbatore, and he asked him to inaugurate the building of the house at around 9:30 in the morning in President Hall. By evening 8:30, V.V. Giri had to open the house. It was completed between 9:30 in the morning and 8:30 in the evening. Father strongly believed that the whole housing shortage in India can be solved within 4 years if they followed building houses as per the development he had made. This was a record and everybody appreciated it. My father was always keen in cameras and photography. He had the first cine camera in Coimbatore and he used it to take the movies on Gandhi's visit and all big politicians coming to Coimbatore. He used to take pictures of them. He visited most camera companies in Germany. He was fascinated with Leica, Minox, Rolleiflex cameras. And he actually spent a lot of time in the factory. Around one of his visits, he discussed with those people and made a crude range finder or distance adjuster as it was called.
ஐயா உங்களுக்கு ஃபோட்டோகிராஃபினா ரொம்ப இன்ட்ரெஸ்ட். அந்த காலத்தில் ஹிட்லரையே அவர் ஃபோட்டோ எடுத்துட்டு வந்திருந்தார். அதை தவிர இங்கே ஏதாச்சும் ஈவெண்ட்ஸ் நிறைய நடக்கும், அதில் எல்லாத்துலேயும் ஃபோட்டோ எடுத்து அவரே ஒரு ஸ்டுடியோவே இங்கே அரேஞ்ச் பண்ணார். ஒவ்வொரு ஃபோட்டோ எடுத்தாலும் அதை கம்ப்ளீட்டாக எல்லாம் அவங்க யாரெல்லாம் இருக்கிறாங்களோ அவங்களுக்கெல்லாம் எடுத்து பிரிண்ட் அனுப்பிச்சு வைப்பார். அதை தவிர கடைசி காலத்தில் மினாக்ஸ்னு ஒரு கேமரா வச்சுட்டு அது ஃபோட்டோ எடுத்தார். அது இப்போ பாக்கெட்லேயே வச்சுட்டு அது எல்லா இடத்துலையும் வந்து ஃபோட்டோ எடுப்பார்.
My father had all type of friends visiting him, from students to scientists and all type of politicians from different parties. For instance, Mr. Visvesraya, C.V. Raman were extremely close friends, and whenever they come, they stay in our house, and whenever father goes to Bangalore, he used to visit them. In the year 1954, Ambedkar visited Gopal Bagh. Indira Gandhi also visited Gopal Bagh. Vajpayee, the former Prime Minister of India, M.S. Golwankar, the founder of RSS, visited Gopal Bagh and stayed with us.
Our Naidu Garu was very unique in moving with Periyar. Periyar, whenever he go to Coimbatore, he used to visit Gopal Bagh. And whenever some important decisions are being taken, Periyar used to consult him. And G.D. Naidu garu also very unique. His new inventions and constructions and machineries, all these things.
Was interested in many things. It is not one field. That is why so many people from all fields, they used to come here, they used to have a discussion with him, they used to invite him to their own industries and their own institutions, and he used to give lectures. So that much he used to attract people by his speeches.
G.D. Naidu was ascertaining a lot of influence over the entrepreneurs of Coimbatore. Many people wonder, whenever we travel outside Coimbatore, frequently asked question is, how is that Coimbatore is so developed in industrial front? One of the main factor for the development of Coimbatore small scale industries is our beloved G.D. Naidu. About in 1969, he called few small scale industries of Coimbatore to his house, advise all of us to start an association of our own to represent to the government and to fight for our cause. Then about 40 people joined together and formed an association. That was a real turning point for the industrial growth of Coimbatore. He was a real patron for the development of small scale industries in Coimbatore.
In the year 1972, I successfully manufactured a calculator using a lot of imported components at that time, and this was the calculator which I made. When I showed this calculator to my father, he was very excited, very happy, but he never appreciated it directly to me. But later I found that he took this calculator and showed it to each and every guest who came, and proudly showed it as my son made it.
When I went to Germany, some friends of mine asked me the question, what do you still have the big board in front of your house which says construction for destruction? So that's when I realized why he encouraged me to break something. It is to learn more about the inside of the toy and be more practical. So today I believe we live in a practical world, and we need to learn hands-on skills, and this is what he always encouraged.
He was a man of people, so he built a GD hospital in Podanur. This was the only hospital which was functioning, and there not only he believed in allopathy, he believed in Siddha medicines and started making medicines for diabetes and leukorrhea. These both were curing many people, and it was so effective and cured many people, and people used to come and get it from all over India, and foreigners also, they used to take the medicine for these disease.
When I could learn the questioning technique of G.D. Naidu, he had the ability to attract VIPs from all over India. He was a self-made man with a rare, very wide view of many technical sectors. Nobody could beat his wide interest not only in technique, but also in farming, in pharmacy, in health, in printing, and very important, publishing his own important ideas and beliefs. G.D. Naidu for me, an individual not to forget.
My grandfather made such a huge impact on Dr. Stoll's life that he said, the best way I can give it back to my grandfather is by giving me a lot of knowledge. So he took me to Germany, he exposed me to being practical, and he contributed a lot towards what I am today. And he runs a company which is today a 3 billion euro company, which is a world leader in industrial automation. And he is still very simple, very down to earth, and has an extremely cordial relationship to all his employees, be it at the highest level or the lowest level. And he always says, I learned all these principles from your grandfather.
My father strictly believed that between friends, if you do business, it's not friendship anymore, and it's not good. But still, the friendship with the Stoll family continues for the 75th year, and they still come to us and we go to them.
I found in Switzerland a very unique piece of high precision. But it's not machined, it's handmade. Put in here 75, and here she put G.D. Naidu Stoll family.
Science Museum, the interactive science museum which we are building. Both these museums could be masterpieces for the whole country, because this country needs many more museums which will show the history of technology. And my grandfather started the vision with the museum, my father is implementing it, and what I would do is optimize it or take it even a next step further and make it more interactive.
G.D. Naidu was always for skill development, right from the beginning. When I was a child of 12 years, he made me work in his factory. And even today, when I made a radio of my own, it was kept in the exhibition which we are having. And he used to tell that when a child drops out of school, even at the age of 8 or 9 or 10, they can stay at home and do something for his life. So we have to also think about those lines, and we are following his footsteps. Whatever he had said, whatever vision he had, we are following it in all our schools.
தன்னோட இன்வென்ஷன்கள் செய்திருக்கிறேன் அப்படிங்களா?
ஆமாம்.
நான் கண்டுபிடிச்சதுன்னு சொல்றது, நான் கண்டுபிடிச்சது ஒன்றும் இல்லை,
அப்போ
இயற்கையாக உள்ளதுதான் அதை செய்த. அந்த மாதிரி ஒவ்வொருத்தரும் ஏதாவது செய்தா, இப்போ கண்டுபிடிக்கிறதுன்னு சொல்றது அது கைக்கும் வருது.
எல்லாருமே செய்ய முடியும்னு சொல்றீங்க.
யார் வேணும்னாலும் எதை வேணும்னாலும் கண்டுபிடிக்கலாம். உலகத்துல எல்லாம் இருக்கு. நீங்க ஏதாவது ஒன்று செய்துட்டு இருந்தா அதை குறுக்க அது வருது, அது நான் கண்டுபிடிச்சு போட்டேன்னு சொல்றாங்க. அந்த மாதிரி நானும் அந்த மாதிரி சொல்லிட்டு இருக்கிறேன்னு இங்க அந்த கண்டுபிடிச்சது ஒன்றும் இல்லை.
During his lifetime, he has developed so many gadgets and products in India first time. If only government had encouraged manufacturing all these items from those days, right from blades, calculators, radios, and many, many gadgets he have developed, India would have become a very big manufacturing country. Even it can beat China even today. If we had the courage or if we had the vision to follow his footsteps and encourage the manufacturing sector to the extent he desired, the story would have been totally different. India would have been a superpower.
In 1973, when he was in his last days, he sold all the buses he had, and the money which he received, he donated everything to schools, to institutions, to NGOs, and whomever came and approached him for a good cause, everything was donated.
In the last days, in 1974, just before he passed away, when he was lying in the bed, he asked me, how does this calculator work? So I said, look, this has got an integrated circuit, it's got... How does an integrated circuit work? It's like a transistor, many transistors inside one chip. Now, as I was explaining some of these things, he'll go to sleep. This went on for a few weeks. He asked me to draw diagrams on the wall near his bed so that he can see it. So he was very, very interested till the last day in getting technical details.
Whether it's engineering, electrical, mechanical, agriculture, transport, whatever he touched, it was a great success. He's all inborn genius. Such a great genius, if he had been born in a Western country, perhaps he would have been decorated with Nobel Prize.
So all these shows that he is a man only wanted to serve the society, but he didn't want to make any money out of it. Even when he did the razor blades, the American government, they were willing to pay him a very high price, but he said, no, it is for my country. And he didn't give it at all. So that shows that he was only for our country. And he, though he didn't say it out, but he was for the people of India and for India and for all of us. He is definitely a great man. He is a wonder man and he is a Edison of India. Thank you.